name is Sabi. I work with the Asia Art Archive. We're a not-for-profit organization that was founded in Hong Kong in 2000. Not to go into much length into this, but we are into building archives. We do dedicated projects to, in fact, work along with personal archives, and we have the pleasure of digitizing and working very closely with some personal archival collections, some of which will be, I think, mentioned here. One of our panelists, Vivan Sundaram, and one of the audience members, Geeta, have also been part of some of our projects. At the archive, what we try to do is, well, build archives. And besides building archives, what kind of conversations can happen around them? And with regard to that, there's lots of stories that open up, there are lots of entry points into the field. And the question that sometimes comes up, or at least the term that comes up often, is about artist estates. It's a term that we hear about often. It's absolutely crucial for a lot of museums, publications that have to work with artist collections of dealing with estates. Now, the question of estates becomes kind of tricky because when you think about it from the perspective of, say, European American museums, what you find is that these are very properly formulated legal entities. You think of million-dollar projects sometimes, you have the Warhol Foundation, you have the Mapplethorpe Foundation, which have had wills written either before the artist's death or by inheritors who have written wills afterwards. You have all kinds of judicial systems in place. I think Amrita perhaps might speak about some of these things, how estates in fact work differently. In the panel today, we will be looking at artist estates from a more ambiguous perspective. We have a scholar who is also trying to put together an estate who does not collect artworks and documents, but has actually put in great effort in consolidating all of these. So the format of today's panel is going to be by beginning with three of the artists. We will begin with one of the most elaborate estates around, artist Vivan Sundaram's estate. We begin with our first speaker, artist Vivan Sundaram. We've had the great pleasure of working closely with Vivan's own archives. We digitized much of it, some of it online. We were, my team and I, my colleagues, we were absolutely astounded by the amount of collection he's amassed, but not just amassed. He's kept it very, very systematically. He's an archivist at heart. So it was inspiring to just, for someone like me who was just getting into archiving, just come across a collection that is so well maintained, so absolutely in order. And I wondered that how exactly does this work when an artist is, on the one hand, keeping everything so systematically, and on the other, is always tossing things all over, turning things on their head, in the kind of art installation that he does. Just a quick introduction to Vivan. His works as an artist address contemporary social issues and the fraught relationship between perception, memory, and history. His works also deal a lot with the archive. Over the years, Sundaram has combined the work of being an artist, writer, activist, and archivist. Committed to creative possibilities that archives offer, Sundaram himself amassed a massive archive of documents and records over the year. Along with his partner, Geeta Kapoor, they opened their personal archive to AAA, to us, for a digitization project in 2010, as I mentioned, which has allowed their collection to be freely accessible online and has come to stand as a valuable resource for a lot of researchers and artists, and we're very pleased with the work that they've allowed us to do with their collection. In 2015, Vivan, along with his sister Naveena Sundaram, a documentary filmmaker and TV journalist, founded the Shergill Sundaram Arts Foundation, and is going to carry forward the legacy of their grandfather, Amrar Singh Shergill, who was a scholar and photographer, and their aunt, a pioneering figure of modern Indian art, Amrita Shergill. In the course of 2015-16, the foundation has been announcing its various initiatives that include supporting photography grants, cross-disciplinary practices, and the reinvention of the well-known Kasauli Art Center, which was an artist-run space that was founded in 1976.
In a technical sense, the government of India has announced a number, not that many, less than a dozen, I think, who are national treasures. So to inherit a small fraction of a national treasure is enabling at one level, but it's also daunting. And what does one do with an estate? And on a personal note, as has already been announced, the formation of the Shergill Sundaram Art Foundation that both me and my sister have no children. So sometimes maybe this relationship of an offspring, a child, would then carry on handling the state. One has to now think of very different strategies, what to do. That I'll come and speak about later on. But an estate obviously is something that you inherit, and it's there in a passive way. And then as you grow older, you realize that it has to then be managed, has to be preserved, conserved. And how does one manage this, the multiple facets of it? And the Amrita Shergill part of the estate is the ownership of paintings as well as of letters. Now the paintings, since paintings are commodities, and commodities have value, so inheriting this capital, this wealth, what does it enable me? Does it give me some sense of power? Does it, what do I do with the money that potentially from the sale of the paintings of, that my sister and I inherit, that do we squander it? Do we extend its use value? Also, I see a relationship between the estate and the archive, because both of them are constantly in process, in unfolding, in being added upon, and then in its availability of entering from the private collection, private ownership into the public domain. And what is the procedure that this this aspect takes? Is it a passive one? Can it be a proactive one? And in my case, since, as already been mentioned by Sabi, that inheriting something of a lineage of a woman who became just at the age of 28, as you can see, an iconic figure. And in any way to take on an icon certainly means that you then can be completely dominated by this icon. And in one sense, I could say that I am dominated by my aunt. But on the other hand, the kinds of positions I've taken is in some way to understand her practice, to then be able to represent it in multiple ways. And I will then briefly go into that. But just specifically to say that the archive of Shergill consists of paintings, of letters, of a vast number of drawings. She started drawing at the age of 7, and it's quite remarkable as a child, but she was so precocious that by the time she was 13 or 14 years old, her uncle, a Hungarian uncle who was a painter, suggested that she go to Paris. So this vast body of work has been digitalized to a fairly great extent. And the second is Umrao Singh Shergill, who is an unknown person. Her father, a photographer, like all fathers inherit or get a camera. And obviously, after marriage and after their children are born, their main subject is their family. And in a sense, the family album is possibly the largest genre that exists ever since the camera became available to a larger public from the late 19th century. The family album is the central document that exists. So any family album obviously gathers in dust, and it's always lying there, and you don't quite look at it because life goes on. But I started getting interested in photography, and started to think of say using some photographs or some paintings. But then subsequently, in looking at Umrah Singh's photographs, I started talking to other photographer friends and said, is this just taking pictures of your wife that you married just incidentally? There'll be one or two shots. Umrah Singh's first wife from his traditional marriage died, and 3 or 4 years later, in 1911, he met a Hungarian woman who came to Lahore and married her. And she, Marie Antoinette Gottesman, is the mother of Umrah Singh's children, their children. So in this aspect of looking at these photographs, it slowly dawned on me and others that Umrah Singh actually was quite a remarkable photographer. The sense in which he composed his photographs, the way that he posed them, and also the other aspect that he took self-portraits across 50 years, from 1892 to 1947. Deepak Anand has written very finely on Umrah Singh, as the word is amateur, but in French, amateur means one who loves and loves. And in a sense, there is a whole aspect of narcissism, both in Umrah Singh as well as in the way that Amrita is photographed. And in it's my bringing from the dusty cupboard into the public domain and representing them as creative statements of mine. Now, Umrah Singh is recognized as one of the pioneers of modern Indian photography. We have a huge, huge legacy of colonial photography, which the great Al-Ghazi has collected of a scale which is unimaginable, and his grandson is taking it forward. But the moment of modern Indian photography has not been so precisely stated, documented, or its historical paradigm placed in the public domain. So, in a sense, as Amrita Shergill is a pioneer of modern Indian photography, Umrah Singh now comes to stand as a pioneer, of modern Indian painting. Umrah Singh is now pioneer of modern Indian photography. So to have two pioneers on your hands is not an easy task. But I have got to know Devika Daulat Singh, a passionate person who loves photography, who then immediately said that a book should come out of Umrah Singh because his photographs are remarkable. And that book, in fact, is a remarkable production of a very high quality of printing. So gradually the estate has come into the public domain through a book on Umrah Singh, and she has very diligently archived every single photograph of Umrah Singh. If there is a vintage print and there are 20 of them, each of them has been. So I think in some sense this amateur photographer's work is now as completely documented, and the SSAF will then, the Shergill Sundaram Arts Foundation will then put this in the public domain for anybody who wants to research the work. Am I going on time? Okay. Now I'm just going to quickly run through a few of my interventions. And in 1995, I put together the works of Amrita Shergill and Umrah Singh Shergill to call it the Shergill Archive. An archive now is a word that its archive fever has spread all over. But at that moment, I did not know that using the word archive as a kind of category for making an artwork is something that is done on a very large scale. So these are all fake boxes. And in these fake boxes are presented different aspects of both Amrita Shergill, but mainly Umrah Singh's photographs. Next, please. I'm just going through that. And these are photographs by Umrah Singh, and I have put them in two strips, and in a sense proposed a kind of narrative for from the family album. Next, please. And then 7 years later, in 2001, I entered the age of the digital and called this series Retake of Amrita. And please ignore the text there, because this was part of another PowerPoint and I couldn't somehow manage to take the text out. That these are all digitally manipulated photographs, and they establish connections and relationships which are false, but they tell a new story or a new truth. Next, please. And then for years I started working on Amrita Shergill's letters, and it took me almost 8 or 10 years to bring out a 2-volume, 900-page book on her letters. But what interested me was how the notes, the normally a footnote that go at the back of the book, will be on the left page, and on the right page will be her writings and letters, which have no footnote number. But on the opposite page, if you see a person or a figure, then you kind of connect it to that. So these half of these 900 pages, more than 400, have a visual graphic like this, and often the reader would, next please, see the references, that how is Ram Clinker Bench come here, and then you kind of weave in an aspect of re-looking or reconnecting to the work. So that's the end of my presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Vivan. What's also interesting to note, and though Vivan's shown two aspects of his engagement with the estate, which is his own art making practice and the book that recently came out. And he didn't mention some of the other books that have also come out via his very diligent engagement with this collection, is the fact that they've also been invested in curating. So there are three facets of how he, as an artist, has dealt with the estate that he's inherited, which is the curatorial, the bookmaking and publishing, and the art making. And now, recently, with the foundation of the Shekhar Sukaramar Foundation, we might take this up in the Q&A about how he's planning this. An important word, this for us to keep in mind, that after having him engage with this collection, is he's used the word narratives. What kind of narratives get released, how much authorship, and determination of the meaning over such collections and such histories come from different quarters, come from the people who own those collections, and how many narratives get released from elsewhere. So we might like to see how this opens up when the rest of the panels are spoken. The next speaker needs no introduction as a photographer, Pablo Bartholomew. He's won several awards, also the Padma Shri Award, which is itself controversial. In 1975, he received his first World Press Photo Award, and in 1984, his work on the Bhopal gas tragedy won him the World Press Photo of the Year. Pablo Bartholomew's father, Richard Bartholomew, was a Delhi-based refugee from Burma, who became one of India's leading art critics and photographers, and his mother, Rati, was an English professor and theater activist, and she had exposed him to a cosmopolitan culture combining Indian and Western modernisms. This informed Bartholomew's visual style, modern and transcending their documentary nature. While teaching himself photography, Bartholomew used his camera to uniquely document India's countercultures, not only revealing a world hidden in the margin, but also sharing his own process of self-making. And it seems a lot of his projects, especially the way he engages with the photography archive, is around self-making in a larger way. And perhaps Pablo can take us through how, number one, he came to possess the collection and what all he has been doing with it. Pablo.
Thank you, Zabi, and great to see you all here. I don't know if I'll be able to unravel with the clarity that Vivan has already spoken about how, when you inherit an archive and what you can do with it. An archive is both a boon, because it's a reservoir of wonderful material that you can go through, or it can be a curse, because to go through the archive that you inherit needs time patience, and of course interest, because if you don't have interest, and that can happen, that siblings or the children are completely skewed towards another area of life, their passions are very different, and then the archive can just sit there and deteriorate. So there are those dangers. What I would try and do is just walk my experience and hope that it has some resonances, brings up some questions. My father, who came from Burma at a fairly young age in his mid-teens, went through school, college, wrote on art, photographed, wrote poetry, and I was sort of quite disconnected with the family as I was growing up because I had my own interests, of course, as a photographer. My mother being in theater, my father being in art, me, I sort of navigated more towards photography because it was easier in the sense that you could be a one-man show. But my photography then took me away to other cities. I was always on the road. And my father died in 1985 when he was the arts administrator at the Lalit Kala Academy. And that sort of then posed many issues and questions for me as to what one would do with all his work. My mother, of course, sensing that she couldn't deal with the photographic material, handed it all over to me. So in 1986, as a dedication to my father, I did a sliver of his street photography work, because that was what I was veering towards at that time. So I looked at only a part of his archive from America, from India, which dealt with the street work, and only of the photographs, because I didn't have possession of the writings at that point. I did the exhibition in Delhi and Bombay. It was kind of interesting. I got good feedback, but in the 80s, photography shows were kind of in Delhi, far and few, nothing sold. So there was no money that came back to go on further, and then that project kind of got buried. I had a nice poster made, and in the poster there were four dedications from his friends. One was from Hussein as the painter, Saeed Jafri as the actor, Dom Moraes as the poet, and there was one more. Anyway, so that was then, and then the photographic material just sat with me till I sort of started winding down my photojournalistic career in the late 90s and started to look at my archive, which I had accumulated from the age of 14. And once I started to do that, basically looking at the archive meant that I digitized all my 30,000 images from the period of 1972 to something like 85. And then once I did that, I realized, well, my father's work is also sitting around, and in that sweep, I digitized his work too. Digitizing it helped me be able to go through it much faster, with computers, programs designed for editing. I was able to structure things, put things into various categories. That helped me then further organize his archive and come out with a publication with three galleries, which are Chatterjee and Lal Photo Inc. and CPA International. And this is the book that I brought out first, called The Critic's Eye. And it basically deals with three kind of parallel connected sections, which is the family portraits, the street photography, and again portraits of his artist friends. So the three are sort of married together in a multi-layered manner. And I then went back to work with my archive and try and do exhibitions. So I was sort of parallelly working with my father's photographic archive and with my archive from my teenage into my late 20s, that body of work. There was always this whole thing for me that I would love to have had his writings as a book. And part of that whole process came from the anger after he died, as how the state forgets people who've contributed to it. And I think this is a phenomena which is probably in South Asia, so it's common to Bangladesh, Sri Lanka, Pakistan. Maybe it happens further in the Southeast Asia also, that memory is very weak, things get forgotten, and I did not want my father's contribution forgotten. So with my mother and another friend of hers, Carmen Cargill, we sort of sifted through the material of his writings. It took 2 years. And then we sat around trying to find people to publish it. Those of you who have the book, the sort of vague history of this is in my acknowledgement or my afterword, where I sort of address the various tangles that we took. We went to an art dealer who said that we were pointed by a painter friend of my father's to an art dealer who said, oh, I'll do a small book, and for that I'll take two paintings from this painter. So I thought to myself, well, you know, I could do better. And why should he be taking paintings from my father's painter friend to do this book? There was another family friend who was in the arts, collected art, photography, and he sat on the work for 4 years, saying that he will do the book, we should be patient. And then I told my mother, come on, let's just get the stuff back, because if 4 years have passed, then it'll never get done. So she tried to get it back, and we only got back part of the archive. So then I had to rebuild the archive by going through the library's scanning material or photocopying material, and then scanning it so that we could have text. Then my mother, you know, who was always all over the place, she was often in Bangladesh and Pakistan because she worked in a women's street theater, had a stroke. So the project kept on getting delayed because my mother said, oh, I'll do it when I come back from here. And then when she came back, she went off somewhere else. So this is the problem of sometimes having a family archive, is if you don't really address it in a pointed, organized manner, things can just drift. And my mother had a stroke, And that sort of, then I thought, well, this project's not going to happen. Until then, when I met Rosalind, who's sitting there typing away at the speed of light, and we restarted working on the book, and finally it happened with a wonderful introduction by Geeta Kapoor, and this is the 640-page book. There are more examples from inside the book on the first floor in the warm data. I have a cabinet with books and posters, both mine, my father's. And to end very quickly is that archives can be very fragile in the sense that if they're not looked after, and there is an example which I've turned into work, which is again in the warm data area, is the story I did from Bangladesh for National Geographic in the box of slides, 200-300 slides was lying in a cupboard. Neighbor's water leakage damaged it, termites came through it. So if you don't look after the archive, paper, negatives, all of these things are highly fragile and can just go. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pablo. The question of fragility of archives, of course, and we might also want to think about the question of fragility of artistic legacies as well. There might be huge archives, there might be a lot of publishing going on. There is a lot of publishing that has happened. You can sit here. The question of the fragility of artistic legacies, there is a lot of publication out there, there is a lot of circulation of information. What legacies get ossified and how do they circulate? Both of these speakers that we've had earlier have in fact activated their archives and activated their collections in interesting ways via very multifaceted routes that they've taken. It would be interesting now to know how a museum deals both with a collection, which is physical, as well as building legacies around artists. And we're going to be now hearing from Kristin Menke. I hope that's the name right. Kristin is a curator and researcher and lecturer focusing on photography and media arts in a transnational context. She is a curator at the Folkwang Museum in Essen. She has been working very closely with, in fact, her work on Germaine Krug goes all the way back to her diploma days. And it's courtesy, Kristin, I suppose, that the Germaine Krug photographs are in the Rewind Station, I suppose. So, what? Yes, yes, thank you. So, for those of you who haven't heard of Germaine Krug, her photographs are on display at the Rewind section of the Dhaka Art Summit. What's interesting about Germaine Krug is that her nationality has been categorized as being German, French, and Dutch. And she spent years in Brazil, Republic of Congo, Thailand, and India. So what kind of questions around legacy are built, especially when so much of discourse and artistic legacy is so rooted in nations? And so I know Kristin is not going to speak specifically about this, but perhaps even the journey of this collection and what the museum's been doing with it. Kristin, over to you.
Thank you very much. I'm happy and excited to be here and to be part of this panel. Thanks, Diana. I don't know if she's left. And Sabi for the kind invitation again to take part in this panel and for having requested some works by the photographer Germaine Krug from the Museum Folkwang. It is wonderful to see them on display here in the Rewind section. And I really think you're helping create a wonderful link. Many things. It was several months ago that Diana contacted the Museum Folkwang, which is located in Essen in the very western part of Germany, about the possibility of showing extracts from the work Germaine Krug did in Burma and India during the 1950s and 1970s. Florian Ebner, who is the head of the photography department and responsible for this step, liked the idea, first of all because of the opportunity it offered to reconsider part of the artist's estate that has only been marginally researched so far, and secondly as a means to involve new audiences in this discourse, in particular establishing links to the regions where the photographs were taken. This was initially pursued through Museum Folkbank's exhibition Voyage Retour, which took place in Lagos, Nigeria in 2013 and presented parts of Jemmy Cole's work for the French resistance in the former French colonies of Equatorial Africa during World War II for the first time on the continent where they were made. Her work was presented alongside works by five different photographers. The presentation of Jemmy Cole's work, focusing mainly on the era of decolonization in Africa. Four of these photographers were represented in our collection, besides the Nigerian photographer, J.D. Okayo-Jekere, who had captured the process of decolonization in his country of origin, Nigeria. Battery is running low. This is another installation that shows J.D. Okayo-Jekere's work. Mobilizing Jemmy Cole's photographs in this way somehow ties in with the artist's biography and her individual concept of life, which was quite dynamic. Cole was born in Poznan in 1897, which is now located in Poland. She grew up in Germany, moved to France in the 1920s, joined the Free French Forces in Brazil during World War II, worked for them in different African countries, came back to Europe, and then relocated to Thailand after the end of the war, from where she relocated once again to India in the early 1970s. And she died in 1985 in the small German town of Wetzlar, where she had spent the last 2 years of her life together with her sister Berthe. I was asked to give you a brief insight into her estate, which has been held by Museum Folkbank since 1995, as well as into the circumstances under which it became part of the museum's collection, which I'm happy to do. First of all, the Jemmy Cole estate is not a closed system, but has been researched and supplemented since it had become part of the collection. The Jemmy Cole estate includes photographs, negatives, magazines, books, private and official documents, specimen copies, press articles, unpublished manuscripts, writings and letters covering almost the whole life of the artist. For the first years after her passing, the artist's estate was managed by a group of her heirs, who later started the Jemmy Cole Foundation in 1987. Given the fact that the foundation was not tied to a public institution, which means that they were not allowed to apply for public funds, quite soon it became obvious that it was impossible to maintain such a diverse and comprehensive body of work, and that there was urgent need for research, restoration, publication, and conservation. But why did they choose to donate, and there was a donation, the estate to the Museum Folkbank? In preparing this piece, I asked Ute Eskildsen, who founded the museum's photography department in 1978 and was the director for many years before she retired in 2012. And who had managed that process. Currently, the department that she built up holds more than 60,000 photographs from the 19th to the 21st centuries by about 1,300 photographers. The vast majority are vintage prints. Apart from individual works and groups of works, the collection possesses numerous lots focused on various photographers or topics and the estates of a range of photographers, artist groups or institutions. The acquisition of artist estates was a key interest of Ute Eskildsen, who intended to acquire at least one artist estate to exemplify a certain point in history or a certain movement. Among the estates held by the photography department One can find, for example, the estate by Wolfgang Wehbaut, who was a pioneer of German photojournalism dating back to the 1920s. Otto Steinert, the famous representative and founder of subjective photography, Helmer Lersky, and of course, Jamin Kohl. Her collecting strategy also makes reference to the central idea of Karl Ernst Osthaus, who founded the museum in 1902. From the very beginning, Osthaus had focused his museum's collections activities on modern art, crafts, and non-Western arts. You can see one example here, which shows how he combined non-Western artworks, in this case, a head and mask from the region of today's Democratic Republic of the Congo, and a Benin head from Nigeria, alongside paintings by Emil Nolde. In this tradition, the photography collection not only focuses on photography as an artistic medium, but also involves applied work, such as commercial documentary and journalism. Another major focus of Ute Eskildsen's work was female photographers from the 1920s to the 1930s, which has led, for example, to the exhibition Fotografien his Teilnehmen, taking photographs when taking part in 1994. One of the first projects developed out of the Jamin Kohl estate was Kim Sichel's exhibition Jamin Kohl, Photographer of Modernity in 1999, which was presented in various venues in Europe and in the USA, to be followed by more specialized research on particular bodies of her work, such as her work from the French Resistance, which was presented in two exhibitions in 2012 and 2013, the second of which I mentioned at the beginning. Currently, we are preparing an edition of her unpublished writings at the museum. But let me briefly come back to the estate itself. In accordance with Jamin Kohl's dynamic biography, her estate also covers several artistic, social, and geopolitical reference areas. One can define three broad groups. The first is her avant-garde work from the 1920s to 1930s, when she was part of the artistic avant-garde in Paris as an important representative of the New Vision movement. Here she was mainly interested in the signs and symbols of industrial progress, that you can see here in her famous publication, Metal, as well as in non-European art, like so many of her peers, but in Kohl's case, this field of interest is lesser known and explored. This was also the time when she had contributed her photographs to various magazines, such as Jazz and Vue, and published, edited, or contributed to various photo books, such as 100 Views of Paris, in this case, in 1929, or Marseille in 1935. This first group covers around 500 photographs. Through 350 photographs, the second group covers the work developed during World War II, and this group of works includes images and documents from La Martinique, Brazil, and the former French colonies in Equatorial Africa, as well as from Northern Africa and Europe. These are examples of the work for the French Resistance, dedicated to labor. And the third group, which is the largest one, involves her post-war work from Southeast Asia. This convolute covers 2,700 photographs, mainly captured between the 1950s and 70s, and mainly dedicated to artworks and cultural heritage sites in different countries all over the region, such as Thailand, Cambodia, India, Burma, and Laos. Given the fact that this is a panel on Asian art archives, a very crucial question came up. Can the Asian body of work within the Jamin Kohl estate be be considered as an archive of Asian art. When I read the title of the panel, I thought immediately I was in the wrong place because I had never considered the German coal estate or part of it as an archive of Asian art. But of course, it might be considered as a meta archive of Asian art, as it comprises reflections on Asian art and on Buddhist culture, including thousands of photographs of artworks and cultural objects, as well as numerous writings and documents that deal with cultural phenomena, religion, and identity. From this perspective, it somehow outlines a shared cultural heritage, which of course is rooted in colonial history and the power relations associated with it. But it also tells us about a process of migration, a very unique one, acculturation and identification, and about the wish to find an alternative approach to Western expectations of Asian culture, which went far further than simply being a source of inspiration for her. I would argue, even though there were always close ties to French colonial and post-colonial politics. Yeah, let me close here and thank you very much for your interest, and I'm keen to know how you think about that. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Krista. Very important question indeed, and I think something that can be taken up as we go forward, and I think this does some way speak to what we were discussing around narrative and what kind of narratives come into play when certain collections accumulate at certain centers and they decide how it should disseminate. Just to keep time, I'm going to quickly introduce you to our next speaker, Amrita Jhaveri, who a lot of us would have at least attended the book launch yesterday. And Amrita Jhaveri established Christie's presence in India in the mid-1990s before moving to London in 2000. As an independent advisor, Amrita has created and managed private and corporate art collections, so she comes in from a very different vantage point here. Ambitious artist projects also have been supported by Amrita and large-scale commissions. In 2010, Amrita established Jhaveri Contemporary, a gallery you must look out for in Mumbai. And the gallery programs both intergenerational and transnational. Yesterday was the launch of the Shamsa book, and I'd like to call Amrita to speak a bit about the essays that she works with.
Thank you, Sabi, and thanks to Diana and Asian Art Archive for asking me to speak. I'd just like to speak from my position as a young gallery, working with estates and families and also with collections. My journey really began with the estate of Anwar Jalal Shamsa, which is actually not really a formal legal entity. It's just Shamsa family that have inherited his works and been looking after them for all these years. Shamsa was born in India, studied and lived in Pakistan before moving to the UK in 1956. He died in 1985. The estate was introduced to me by Green Cardamom, who actually, as Hamad said at the book launch, he discovered his work only by going to visit a framer in Karachi and saw these two incredible works and was immediately drawn to them, wanted to find out more about them, and discovered that this entire body of work lay on the south coast with the family, the south coast of England, sort of practically forgotten and really not much in circulation. Anwar showed, I think, fairly regularly during his lifetime in Pakistan, and upon his death in 1985, his wife took a large group of works that he was planning to show, almost, I think, 100 works, that he had, was planning to have an exhibition in 4 venues in Pakistan, and she fulfilled that dream of Anwar's, and then the works probably just lay in England for a long time. There was maybe a show, a regional show in Birmingham, but there hadn't been very much else going on. When Hamad got involved with it, he put 2 exhibitions on at Green Cardamom and invited 2 curators to look at different aspects of Anwar's work. Iftikhar Dadi from Cornell came and spent time with the family and documented quite a lot of work and scanned all the all Shamsa's diaries and notebooks and things like that. Green Cardamom had also placed his works in some key collecting institutions, which was really important. So Tate had acquired 3 works, the Metropolitan Museum had acquired some work. As a result of the Tate acquiring 3 works, they then began thinking about having an entire display devoted to Shamsa's works. So that sort of slowly was being discussed internally, and the display has just gone up in October 2015. The first thing that I did really was go and spend a little bit of time with the family. They had most of the work in their home, so saw absolutely everything that they had. Fortunately, one of the granddaughters is an archivist working in the Bank of England, so some of the works, I think what Green Cardamom had done was documented a lot, but there was not organized in a way that I could have easy access to. So I needed to understand from the gallery's perspective exactly how many works there were, what possibilities there were, and what we could do with them, and how we could build on Hamad's 2 exhibitions and possibly do a 3rd exhibition. The gallery's in Mumbai, and I thought if I did it, the 3rd exhibition in Mumbai, it might be difficult because I didn't really know him. In India, doing exhibitions with Pakistani artists in Mumbai is a challenge. We do them all the time, but we risk them being closed down or we're facing problems. There's, of course, all this work is in England, and importing the work into India is also a big issue. There was an opportunity that came up for us to show a body of work at Art Dubai, and I thought, well, you know, I really should do an exhibition before I do an art fair, but I thought, well, where am I going to have it? And this seemed like a good place. So we did a very focused presentation of works from just 1 series of square compositions. These were pictures that hadn't been shown before in the 2 exhibitions that Hamad did. And I commissioned a text for it and did a little publication for the art fair. While I was at the art fair, I realized that people, curators, would come and say, well, what can we really take away? And although the family had meticulously kept a lot of exhibition catalogs and pamphlets and brochures, they weren't really collated in any kind of way that they could easily be taken away. So as a gallery, the first thing I did was put together what I call a research document, which has scans of all the catalog essays, a lot of things that are out of circulation that we can now easily forward on to people. Then I started thinking, well, it would be nice also to have something more substantial in the form of a book. And then the problem was, how are we going to raise the funds for putting this book together? I first identified the right publisher. This is Writing House, and they work with a lot of older artists, especially modern British artists, and do books, like the quality of what they were doing. And I thought, what kind of book could I have? There certainly wasn't anybody who was going to write a single essay of 15,000-20,000 words. So what I did was commission 3 essays and took the 2 essays that Green Cardamom had commissioned for their exhibitions. Thoughts about what kind of writers I wanted and aspects wanted into the book. And I definitely, one of the things that's important for me as a gallery is to have older artists I work with in conversation with younger artists as well, so their work doesn't seem to become isolated as kind of modernist. And in the marketplace in India, there seems to have become this division between what is modern and what is contemporary, which I don't think is really very relevant. So I wanted to have a young artist who collected Shamsa's works and was engaged with Shamsa's practice to contribute an essay. So Shehzad Dawood, who's a young artist living in Pakistan, living in the UK, did a piece for us. And we had an academic at Brown University come in and talk about the England in the 50s environment and the art schools in England in the 50s and 60s. And Hamad did a fantastic piece for the book as well. So we focused basically on the art fair presentation, and then I did an exhibition in England on his prints, because he's an incredibly sophisticated and experimental printmaker, and this was not something that was very well known. So we did a show of prints, and when I was doing the show, I learned that he didn't actually, although they had edition numbers on prints, he hadn't actually printed all the prints, and we don't know how many prints he actually made and where they are. Also discovered that Mary, his wife, has actually kept all the printing plates. So we're now thinking, is this something we can do in terms of maybe looking at re-editioning or remaking some of these prints? So I'm just kind of doing some research around that to see what's possible. Just wanted to talk a little bit about the challenges that I've had working with it. A lot of Shamsa's works is dispersed. And we constantly get asked for exhibitions and where works are, so trying to really learn from Green Cardamom and where they put the works, also when the family sold the works, who they sold the works to. When works come up at auction, I've said to the family from sales that they make from works that are currently with them, we should possibly together defend the works that come up at auction and maybe possibly try and acquire some works so we have them in our collection jointly. So the gallery puts in some funds, the families put in some of the money, and we bought some works from auction, if they're affordable, so that we can actually build up a library of works that we can lend out of. For example, the Tate's done a show at the moment. The show is on for a year. It's free to everybody. But the issue is that a lot of the works are locked into that exhibition for a year. And there are other exhibition opportunities that we really can't, we don't have enough works to support. It's a small estate, so it's under 500 works. And of course, there's the emotional side of things. The family wants to hold on to a lot of their own works, and I'm trying to convince them, as long as we can place them in good places where they'd be available to the public, that they should maybe think about letting go of some more works and not just having them all in a home. You know, questions about where can we show this work in the region. I've never been to Pakistan. I don't know the infrastructure, the art scene there. Getting visas for me is difficult. So Dhaka seemed like a great opportunity because this work has never been seen here. And India has its own problems. So if all of you can go up and see the Shamsa's work. there are other collections I worked with, and I wanted to talk a little bit about those, but I don't think we have time. I've worked with a collection, a private collection of photography also by Lionel Brent, but it's not in state, it's a collection. And of course, when showing that in the region here, we have issues of censorship, so we've had to bring works to Dhaka that are very specific because a lot of the works are male nudes, and we can't show those in Dubai, we can't really show them in Dhaka. We have then, in this instance, shown them in India. So that's one thing. And as I said, it's important for me to show these works in conversation with younger artists, so I'm going to continue to do exhibitions, for example, of Shems's works with younger artists like Seher Shah, and also with Rana Begum and others, and look at their interest in architecture and Shems's interest in architecture as well. So that's just a little bit about what I do and how I work with the states, and I'm going to continue to work with them. I enjoy the long, slow process. I enjoy working on publications, and hope I can do more with some of the states that I'm going to be working with going forward. Thank you. Here's just a copy of the book, so.
Thank you, Amanda. I can't wait to go through the book as well. Protocols of access. How do we understand those protocols of access when an estate is a very small entity and works are dispersed all over? Who gets access to them? How do they get access, and what do they make use of once that access is given? We're going to move on to our last speaker, whose work on a Burmese artist, Bagyang So, phenomenal. Because if we're talking about dispersed estates, we're talking about dispersed collections, but Bagyang So's collection is a hallmark of such a phenomenon. Yin Kerr is the adjunct assistant professor in the School of Historical Studies in Singapore. We at AAA have had the delight of publishing one of her essays on Bagyang So in a publication titled Mapping Asia. Bagyang So was a Burmese painter who had the opportunity to travel to Shantungeta. And it had impacted his work immensely, and some of his works can be seen also in the Rewind section here. Yin Kerr will be speaking a bit about a collection that does not exist as a collection, I believe. It's dispersed across Indonesia, Burma, I suppose parts of South Asia. So I'll hand over to Yin Kerr. We're running out of time, so I think the Q&A is going to be very important for all of us. So quickly on to Yin Kerr.
Sharing my recollections of how what we might call an estate came about and what I tried to do to activate it. Now, I don't own these materials. I don't have any blood ties with the artist. I am not even Burmese. There is clearly, it's not a legal entity at all. And the government of Burma clearly has no interest in looking into this either. So the works are in the hands of private collectors, mostly in Singapore and in Burma or Myanmar. It is very likely that some of the works have left Burma along with the intellectual diaspora in Australia and UK and US, but I've not had the resources to hunt down these collections as yet. A brief introduction of the artist. He was born in 1924, passed away in 1990. So the relevance of him with South Asia is that he was in Shantiniketan and on an Indian government scholarship in 1951. And thereafter, all the works he did, I think we could link back to the teachings he received in Shantiniketan. And his continued dialogue with Shantiniketan's teachings was such that it very much even isolated him from the rest of the artistic community in Burma. Now, I'll just go through what this so-called estate might consist of. Okay, primarily, paper works, very fragile works of ink and felted pen on paper, definitely no larger than A4 size. Okay, we have drawings, sketches as well from the very early period, and very importantly, illustrations. Now, these illustrations have no commercial value basically because they are not the originals, they are printed matter and very, very poor quality as well. But they are very important for reconstituting the artistic evolution of the artist throughout the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s. And they are very important for recounting, retracing the history of 20th century Burmese art as well. Okay, other materials. Okay, this is an example of what a poor, printed copy of the illustration is of the original. Now, other materials, more examples of how his work has evolved and why they are very important in our reconstitution of his career. Other materials include manuscripts, written exchanges, because he couldn't hear well, so he basically communicated by writing. We also have articles he wrote and he published a lot. We have journals, diaries, we have books with his notes on them, exhibition invitations, and then as well as movie posters. Now, he was a very famous movie actor. This has got nothing to do with the art, but I think in understanding his persona, you cannot not look at the movies he made and the kind of image he projected, which also impacted the image of him as an artist as well. Now, today, just the illustrations and original works alone, we have about 6,000 works. And given that at his most prolific period, he was doing something like 80 illustrations per month, easily there could be another 5,000 works out there. So we don't know. Now, a little bit on how my relationship with this so-called estate came about. It started in 1997, 1998, when I first saw his works, which I couldn't understand at all. I come from a background of painting, and usually I think when I look at an image, I kind of have an idea of how the painter put together that image and translated it into more concrete forms. But when I saw his works, the first images you saw, I was just like a blank, so I wanted to understand why. And so in 2001, I went to Burma to track down his other works. The first works that I saw were in Singapore. That was in a gallery, and it was the first time the works were taken out of Burma in 1996 and shown on a public platform as works of art. So 2001, I went there for the first time, and I think in hindsight, it took me something like 5 to 10 years to really gain the trust of the family and friends before they really opened up all their collection to me and shared stories with me. Stories are very, very important. Although I didn't mention it just now, I think oral history is a very important part of the reconstitution of the artist's work as well. In other words, when I talk about estate, I'm actually talking about memory, the memory of this artist. Anything that contributes to the reconstitution of his memory and how I, as maybe like more like a guardian, can build on it and take things further. So I think by 2005, I was thinking of ways to give back as well, because I benefited a lot from the stories that they shared with me. The poets, the writers with whom the artist was very close. He was closer to the writers and the poets than the artists. So I started thinking about staging exhibitions. It's a way of telling the people in Burma that I didn't take you for a ride, I wasn't wasting your time. But it was very difficult working with institutions. They changed timelines, then there was no budget, things like that. So what happened was I took it online, I created a website where I could stage virtual exhibitions, but I realized that it didn't really work very well because Very few people were reading the text that I was writing, and most people accessing it were people in Burma. So I created a Facebook page to reach out to a wider audience, something like bite-sized information. And I think in 2011 and 13, there were a large number of people in Burma who played vital roles in the reconstitution of this story of the Jin Aung-san who passed away, and I was very ill as well. So that got me to thinking about a more systematic way of transmitting whatever materials I have. And that led me to the creation of this database of all his illustrations. Today we have almost 4,000 odd illustrations, everything that's put online and available to everyone. And I think my aim was to get it to reach the largest public as possible, to take it out of Burma, and hopefully to inspire to get young scholars to work on these, because I think the story of an artist lives on only if it's seen through evolving lenses. If not, it disappears and it dies. So that's my priority when I deal with these materials. Okay, just some considerations is that I think both Liban and Pablo have mentioned it as well. Dealing with an estate or memory like this, there's a lot of duties and responsibilities as well. And in trying to get his work disseminated, there are some considerations. Like, for example, he was against the art market. So does getting him known mean I want to make him the most famous artist sold at the highest price, getting him into an institution, a prestigious institution in Europe, America? Maybe not so, because I think that's not what he wanted. He didn't make art to be sold. He gave these works away. And the reason why he did make so many illustrations so that his art could reach out to the largest public possible, that people didn't need money to appreciate and enjoy art. So that's a major consideration, and I don't know how an artist who doesn't play according to the rules of the art market actually might have a place in the international art world today. So maybe you could give me some ideas as to how to go about doing that. Thank you.
Fascinating panel, many different vantage points. We have very little time, so I want to open the questions up to the audience here. But I hope you would indulge me in asking the first question, which is that I work at an archive. It's interesting that we were discussing estates, artists' legacies, and archives kept figuring in. And a lot of people come to me to ask, you know, I have a collection. I'm sure a lot of you here have all kinds of collections that you want to archive. And they ask me, you know, how do we go about archiving it? Similarly, a lot of questions are there among people about how to build an estate, what do we have to do, is it registered? And I think all the examples we've had here today are non-legal entities, or non-registered entities, which have been referred to as estates, right? So I want to open up the first question about estates, which I like the way Maki Angso's example of how to really bring relevance or reactivate this collection without necessarily following the same rules of market or these kind of things. Really clear. So I wanted to open up the question with, so we're not looking at registered entities in the estates, right? And I'm going to direct this question first to Vivan and Amrita, and then please feel free to pitch in. Does it matter that these have to be registered entities? It probably does. If it does matter, why or how does it matter? Because I'm sure you're coming across, you know, entities or archives which are properly formulated, estates which are properly founded. A lot of people have collections here, and when they do, they kind of want to figure out what they can do with it. So does it matter that we should have legal entities such as estates? We have an example of Germaine Krug, which is institutionalized in a museum. It's not an estate, from what I understand, as a family inheritance, but different kinds. So the institutionalization of collections, of archives, is what I wanted to address to Vivan. If Vivan can answer first, because just recently he has founded and established the Sheikh Sundar Amar Foundation, so perhaps you could begin briefly.
Okay.
you're suddenly this daunting word, registered, are you registered? It's all, well, in a general sense or another sense, Amrita Sheridan, since she is national property, her works cannot be exported in terms of, they can only be sent abroad. But even to be sent abroad, you have to get the Archaeological Survey of India to give permission to send them. And in fact, there was a major show at the Haus der Kunst, and the director of the National of the Archaeological Survey came to the house and he said, you can't send this abroad, this is an important painting. So he exercised the right that I can't send particular paintings, South Indian villagers going to market, because that's something he knew. So in one sense, it is framed that these are national treasures and if they are put up in auction. So in an indirect sense, all her works, and since I in my book have you know, put every single work that I know, and since then about 5 or 7 works, you know, have appeared, and they're not forgeries, many are forgeries, so that number would grow. So the fact that every work of hers is already in the public domain through my publication, is that an indirect way that they are registered? That's one. But that's only paintings. And what do you do with all the watercolors and sketches? And then the next question I have to ask myself and pose it to the Sheikh Sundar Mal's Foundation is that when both me and my sister and my wife Geeta are no longer there, then will it be important to register everything so that what the foundation gets is a registered body of work and it saves and protects it?
Thank you.